Assalamu alaikum everyone. So this is Ms. Karbashare, and on behalf of ERC, let me welcome you all to this training session entitled Theories of Motivation and Their Classroom Application. So a lot of people are still joining. I hope so. I am audible to everyone. Kindly let me know if I'm audible to all of you with the help of the chat box. All right. Yes. Okay. So before formally moving towards our training session, let's have an introduction to me and then to you all. This is Karba, and I have been working in as a student counselor and faculty trainer at ERC. Apart from this, I am a linguist from profession, but by passion that I am in the field of this counseling and training from around 3 years. Moreover, I have been associated with a lot of organizations who have been working for the language development. Now, I would like to know the details regarding the participants that we have in our session. Previously, we had people from Philippines, Thailand, and from around multiple different countries of the world. This time, I would like to know where are you all from? So your name, the country you are currently residing, and your designation is required. I am awaited to see in the chat box. Kindly note your name, your country, and the designation is required. Okay, so we have Ms. Kulsoom from Pakistan, who is a language facilitator. It's good to see you, Ms. Kulsoom. Then we have Ms. Faiza Kiran, who is a teacher by profession, is from Karachi, Pakistan. Then we have Kartikyan Balasubramanian. I'm so sorry for the wrong pronunciation again. Okay, so a librarian by profession. Then we have Irma Galang Dule from UAE. That's nice. Irma is a kindergarten teacher, right? Okay. And right, perfect. We have Nida Maksud from Pakistan, English teacher in Beacon House school system. Great. We have Ruvais from UAE. That's so nice to see people from abroad as well. All right, so in the meanwhile, other people are joining. Let's start as it was scheduled at 1 p.m. So basically, I'm in this field of training, and if you have attended my previous sessions as well, then you must have noticed that I am playing my role for bringing the change in the traditional mindsets that teachers basically have, or the methodologies they are following, which are basically outdated as well as boring for a student of this century. So as you all know that things have developed and technology has came into the picture, thus the teachers of the century need to be updated in order to bring a change in this educational sector. So it's been a pleasure to see you all here. We are from different origins, maybe from different fields as well, but the motive of today's session is that we'll be rethinking and revising our teaching methods to be the most effective ones. I hope you all must be very, very competent in your fields. But in today's session, we'll be trying our level best to reanalyze the methods that we are following, and we'll try to bring in the change wherever it is required. So first of all, let's have the overview. We'll be looking deeply into the concept of motivation, the types of motivation, the teacher's misconceptions, the theories, Maslow's hierarchy, ARC's motivational theory, and equity motivational theory. So let's move towards the concept of motivation. So what drives us to do the things that we do? Or what is that pushes us to accomplish things? A simple answer would be personal gain, But the question is much more complex than that. There are many ways to look at the concept of motivation, but among them, one is to examine the motivation examples to identify more about it. Let's have a worldly definition for it. So motivation is typically defined as the forces that account for the arousal, selection, direction, and continuation of behavior. So we all move in a particular direction and we continue any behavior. The reason is that there is a force, there is a stimuli behind that. So our acts are basically because of a reason, and there is always a force, and that force is the motivation. The key ability of successful people is that they know how to motivate themselves effectively. But the problem that we face in our classrooms is that students don't know how to motivate themselves in the right way. And if they are even motivated, the point is of sustainment. Do we really know how to sustain their motivation till the last minute of the session? Or do we really know how to motivate them or how to sustain their motivation till the last session of the whole year? So now this is what the area is where the teachers are going to play the role, and this session will surely help you out. It is basically an internal process, and whether we define it or not, of course, it is a drive or a need that the condition inside us that desires a change, right? So in order to identify the examples, we'll be heading towards the types of motivation, and I'm sure you all must be aware of all those types. So can I have the answer in the chat box that how many types of motivation are there? And moreover, there is a message from Mr. Anis Rahman. He's from Erbil. I would like to know, where is this Erbil, by the way? Also, the chat box is open, and I would like to know about the types of motivation you all know up till now. Okay, so Ms. Kilsom is saying this is intrinsic and extrinsic. That's perfect. Then Faiza is saying there are three types of motivation. Yes, there are so many, but the basic ones are intrinsic and extrinsic. Okay, so let's move ahead with the types of motivation. So first of all, we have extrinsic motivation, which refers to the behavior of individuals to perform tasks and to learn new skills because they know they'll be getting external rewards for that. And of course, they won't be punished. So in order to avoid that punishment and in order to get those external rewards, they act in a particular way. So in this case, you engage in behavior not because you enjoy it or because you find it appealing, satisfying, or even relaxing. But you engage in this behavior in order to obtain something of value in return or avoid something unpleasant. As already mentioned, the avoidance of punishment. Let's move ahead with the intrinsic motivation. It is performing an activity for its own sake rather than the desire for some external reward or out of some external pressure. So if you like gardening and you do it, then it is a reason of relaxation, a reason of peace to you. It has nothing to do with the external things, right? But this is something that is making you feel relaxed. So this is called intrinsic motivation. I have this diagrammatic representation on the right hand as well, where you can see the distinction between intrinsic and extrinsic. So extrinsic is, of course, the praise, money, respect, grades, whereas intrinsic is the curiosity, achievement, interest, and pride. this is what we need to identify when we are moving ahead in our careers as well, that what is what we actually want to do, and we need to identify what are the external factors that are putting on pressure on us, and just because of that we go towards the wrong decisions. Let's move ahead towards the misconceptions. I feel that the teachers who are teaching in our and the other societies, they all teach the way they were taught at their school level, or they were taught at their own learning time. Now, this is what the problem is. When you were taught, that was a different time, that was a different decade, that was a different scenario. But when you are teaching, then the audience is different, the decade can be different, and there will be another difference like of technology. I remember when I was at my school time, there was no such interference of technology at that time. It was just like we used to have computer laboratories and that's it. We do not used to have such assignments that were required to be done via computer. But now if you talk about it and you know that online learning has come into the picture, then this time is different. And when I am teaching in a class, then I need to know, I need to prepare myself accordingly. I cannot follow the same technique, the same method, the same strategy which my teacher has used when I was learning. Because of this reason, there are some misconceptions, and I believe that needs to be clear first before moving towards the theories. So the first misconception is that some students are unmotivated. We must have heard the sentence from the teachers in our surroundings, and they say that the students are unmotivated. But to be really very honest, this is not an accurate statement. As long as the student chooses goals and it spends a certain amount of effort to achieve, then he is or she is by definition motivated. Now, what teachers really mean by this sentence, let me explain it as well. They mean that students are not motivated to behave in the way teachers would like them to behave. Now, this is the reason that teachers are claiming or blaming the students as unmotivated. This is the first misconception discovered, and we'll be talking more about it in the theories as well. Now let's head towards the second misconception. Okay, just give me a minute. All right, so the second misconception here is as well. It's that one person can directly motivate another. Now, here the problem is, motivation is something that is inside you, and this view is inaccurate as well. What you can do with the help of various motivation theories, we'll be of course discussing in the session, but it is basically to create the circumstances that influence students to do what you actually want them to do. So students will not be motivated by seeing another student. There will be some sort of motivation, but that will be a few persons. But you are actually the person who can make the condition favorable, who can inspire the student and who can motivate the students during the class. And it is up to you. And it is up to you to create such situation in the class that the students feel motivated. There are many factors that determine whether the students in your class are motivated to learn or they are not motivated to learn. But you should not be surprised to discover that there is no single theoretical interpretation of motivation explaining all the aspects of a student interest or lack of it. There are different theoretical interpretations. However, they shed light on each and every different aspect. Also, they can serve as the basis for the development of techniques for motivating students in the class. So as we are heading towards the theories of motivation, we'll be exploring such bases that you all can use, and you can develop your own methods, your own techniques for motivating the students present in your class. The very first theory is Maslow's hierarchy theory, and I hope so you all are already familiar of it. So it was given and presented by Abraham Maslow. And this actually gives a pyramid that suggests that people are motivated to fulfill the basic needs before moving on to the other needs. The pyramid is here, and you can see the very first basic level is physiological, where we are talking about the food, shelter, and clothing. You all must have seen that there are people who are in masses. They are not, of course, that much educated, but the political parties target them with this physiological need. They know that they people are not educated, and they can cater them very easily. So that is why they use this slogan of food, shelter, and clothing to target the masses and to reach them out. Now, if the student is having enough sleep and enough food, then of course the student would be thinking about being active, playing in the class. Even if we talk about ourselves as human beings, If my stomach is full, of course, I would be thinking about shopping. I would be thinking about gatherings. I would be thinking about the outings, right? But if I'm not in, you can say not filled up, there is someone, let me admit. Right. So if these needs are not fulfilled, of course, I won't be able to step up to the other needs. Let's look these needs in the picture of a classroom, and let's have a look how they can be used in the class. So as mentioned, the very first need is that you need to have enough sleep, enough food, and clothing. So if the students are getting enough sleep that is required and enough food at home, they are more likely to be active at their school. Now, it is important for a child to feel secure within the classroom, and this is what the teacher's responsibility is, to feel them secure in the classroom. This is also not only a thing, a part of a classroom, and we can also look at it from a different prospect. If you are doing a job, if you are a part of any organization, if you are the one who is not being respected in your organization, you are more likely to be demotivated. What you need to make sure there is that if you are at the position, if you are not maybe at any higher position, if you are even the colleague as well, you need to make sure that the other employees are comfortable and they feel themselves respected. Even if they are doing something bad, you need to make sure how you can play your role in that picture. Now, if you are a teacher in the class, you need to make sure that each and every child of the class feels secure. If they are feeling secure, of course, then they'll be able to establish the relationship, the friendship with the other students, and they are more likely to actively participate in the class. Let's move towards the third step. So as I told about the activeness and the social relationships, point two and point three are interconnected. So if a student does not feel likely they belong, of course, it will be the thing that they won't be able to focus on their learning. Now here, one more thing is important. It's that we all know such students in our class who are less likely to act or who are less likely to perform well in their class. Now, what happens with them? They have this feeling of isolation or they are being avoided by the teachers and the other students of the class. This is the picture of the school. And when they come back to the family, they are again the ones who are feeling isolated because their siblings, their elder or younger sister and brother are getting good grades and they are not. That is why they have this feeling of negativity in them. This is the same case when they are going to the social gatherings and people sometimes mock or bully them as well. Now, this is the reason that they indulge in some negative gatherings and parents and teachers get worried and blame that the student is going towards a negative gathering. But they really don't know that they have also played their roles in moving them, in making them, in forcing them to go towards such gatherings. The fourth one is that if the student has low self-confidence or, of course, low self-esteem, he or she would not be able to develop creatively, nor he would be able to develop problem-solving skills. I remember I had a case in my class when I was at my university level. There was a friend of mine who had very, very, very low self-confidence. The thing was that she was not even able to question something, even if she had during the class with the teacher. And I remember whenever she tried asking, she started shivering. So this is what the teacher must make sure. I remember how the teachers of my time used to pamper her. What they had done, they had allowed her that she can come right after the class to discuss about any query with them in personal. And with the passage of time, I have seen her in my 4 years of graduation that she has grown a lot. Right now, she is among the most confident ones, and you people, if you people get a chance to see them, you people would be really shocked and you people won't even believe that she was such type of student at the time. Now, the last stage, that is the self-actualization, important for a lot of people. And there are a very few people in our society who have it. The rest do not. I have even seen people who have done PhDs and MPhils, but they do not have this feel of self-actualization. They are still convinced to satisfy others. They are still convinced towards the other's opinion. Basically, it's the self-actualization is that you are aware of what you are. You are concerned about your growth, yourself. You know where do you stand. And you are not much concerned about the opinions of others. And you are not much concerned in satisfying them. So this state is very important. And here, this is what the job of a teacher is, to make the students feel this much satisfied during the class. I hope so. You all will be using these in your classrooms. And you all people are making notes so that you people can develop some of the strategies that can be used in your classrooms for making your lessons deliver more effectively. I am heading towards the another theory, that is ARCS motivational theory. This is quite simple one. As here, A is standing for attention, R for relevance, C for confidence, and S for satisfaction. So attention is basically that the teacher is able to get during the class. I remember when I used to teach, at my time, there used to be, as it was a language classroom, there used to be around 30 to 35 people. But I am 110% sure that I was able to get the attention of all those 36 people. And even if any of the student has missed, I can sense in a minute, I can sense even in seconds that this person is lost and not thinking about the class, but thinking about something else. This is a sort of connection that every teacher should make during the class. Now, let's talk about the relevance. The problem that us all is that we do not have relevant examples in the class in which we are not able to relate with the student. Now, for suppose if I know that a lot of people right now in the session are from a teaching background, and I myself from maybe a different background, and I am giving the examples of those background, maybe you can say of engineers, maybe of doctors, and I'm not talking about the teachers, how you people would be able to make a connection? Of course, you people will feel boring. And you are more likely to leave the session before the end. This is what the place, as I have talked in the last theory as well, and in the introduction too, that sustaining that motivation till the last second of the session, till the last lesson of the whole year. This is what you need to make sure that you are being relevant in your class and sustaining the motivation till the end. As you are making relevance, you need to make sure you are making the student feeling confident so that they can come up with their theories, they can make relations, and they can solve easily the problems during the class. The last one is satisfaction. Of course, that comes after the attention, relevance, and confidence, that if students know that they'll be getting reward, and even if they get, what is reward in the class? The reward can be you are praising anyone. The reward can be you are saying, okay, there is this one math that we all will be having, a student of the day. Okay, and who will be the student of the day? All the students will be active in the class to be the student of the day. And towards the end of the session, you can announce, okay, so let's say Aisha is the one who is the student of the class. So this reward is going will be giving them satisfaction that they were looking for during the whole section. Let's head towards its classroom application. So as attention, our students' attention has to be aroused and sustained. And there are two main ways with which you can do it. The first one is perceptual arousal, and the second one is inquiry arousal. As mentioned, uses surprises and uncertainty to gain interest. What you can do, you can use humor during the class. I remember a colleague of mine uses it often in order to keep the students attentive during the class. Let me see, there are some messages in the chat box. I don't know, am I audible to everyone? There is someone who is saying that I'm not audible. Can you please all let me know if I'm audible? All right, Ms. Hina, I guess there is some problem with your device. You can try logging in with another device because I am audible to everyone. Right, okay. So if we talk about inquiry arousal, then it stimulates curiosity by posing challenging questions. As someone has rightly said, there are some examples required for the secondary grade or the adults as well. Then here what you can do, you can indulge them in sort of practical work. You can you can ask them to brainstorm about the topic that you are studying. As you know that the topics are interconnected in the senior grades, like if you are teaching any topic of science in 8th class, then of course it must be having any connection with the topics he or she has studied in the 7th grade. So if you are following this inquiry arousal, you can ask them to brainstorm and or you can ask them to write down their prior knowledge so that you can move ahead. This will be helping you out in managing the time as well. And then, of course, you will be indulging the students during the class too. Okay, so the relevance is same. If the content is perceived to be helpful in accomplishing one goal, then of course they are more likely to be motivated. I remember at my time, at my university level, we used to have such teachers who use such examples and who used to relate to us. So they used to give us such examples that were really very, very relevant. And I remember I used to be active only in those class. But if I talk about the other sessions and the other class, I used to be not that much active. Then there is this confidence, as already mentioned, that the students have to know that they will probably be successful before completing a given task. As mentioned, there can be student of the day, there can be student of the week. You make monitors in the class. This is what increases the confidence of the students. I am moving towards the last theory. And it's the equity motivational theory. This is quite simple, but it was given in an organizational background. But in today's session, we'll be relating it to the classroom application. So equity theory attempts to explain the relational satisfaction. Now here, you will be comparing what you are getting, what you are giving with what the other is giving and what the other is getting. Now, if we talk about in an organizational setup, if I am hired at any particular designation and the other person is hired at the same designation, we both have same skills, or maybe we both do not have same skills, not same experience, but what are the efforts that I am putting in my job and what is the return or the salary I am getting in return? If I talk about the other person that is hired on the same position, then what are the efforts he or she is putting in and what is the reward that he or she is getting it? Now, this is where when I'm going to compare both the things, here the satisfaction or the motivation comes. If I feel like that I'm not fairly paid, if the output is not fair, then of course I am more likely to be demotivated. Whereas the other person who is not even giving such efforts but getting a very good reward, that person will be motivated. So the inputs are basically effort, loyalty. The categories are given here, you can go through. But all these are the ones that you are giving to the people who are there in that setting. That can be the boss, superior, support, colleagues. And if we talk about in a classroom setup, it can be the teachers, principals, co-teachers, students, and all. And if we talk about the outputs, then the outputs can be tangible as well as intangible. If we talk about the tangible ones, then they are, of course, the expenses, benefits, salary. And if we talk about it in the classroom picture, then the outputs can be grades, marks. Whereas if we talk about the intangibles, that is the praise, thanks, reputation. One thing that is missing with a lot of people is that they do not have the acknowledgement. Basically, they do not acknowledge other person's effort. This is the reason that the other person sometimes feel demotivated. So if you cannot give something that is in sort of money, if you cannot give something like that, then try to at least give this sort of acknowledgement to people. This is also a source of motivation to them. I remember that I have I have stayed somewhere for more than a year. I have worked somewhere for around like 3 years. I remember that the pay was not that much sufficient, but the praise and the conditions made me work there for a long time. So this is important as well. Now let's have a look to this formula that is very simple, and as I have mentioned too, it's that simply the input that I am putting. So let's take it into the picture of a student. If the student is putting certain efforts and the student is not getting that output, the student will be comparing this condition with the other student, maybe the one who has the same skills like him. So he'll be comparing it that, okay, this is the efforts I put and these are the efforts that guy put, right? Now the output that a student is taking and the output the other student is getting. If these conditions are equal, only then the student will be motivated. And if these conditions are not equal, then of course the students will be demotivated. I remember this used to happen at the university levels as well, where a few students in the class were the favorite ones, and it happens everywhere, I guess. But the others are as not the favorite ones, then they are not getting the same output. So this was actually the reason. Moreover, there is one more thing that I have observed with some of the primary and the secondary teachers as well, that we know that there are some students who are good at reading. So we always ask those students to come forward and to read aloud the chapter. But we do not motivate, we do not appreciate the students who are not good at reading to come forward in front of the class and read aloud. So this is what the problem is, or you can say our source of demotivation to them. How you can apply it in the class? It can be done with the help of the group work. It can be done with the help of the individual work. Basically, group work and individual work is that where the students are exploring the efforts they are putting and the efforts the other ones are putting. You know that the students do not share that much how do they study, but when they work in a group, they got to know, okay, this is how this person is working and this is how I work. I remember I used to take notes of things, but my notes used to be very scattered always. But I have encountered a friend of mine who used to be very organized, and she used to work with colorful pens. That was very interesting, and whenever I used to learn from her notes, I remember it. So this is where I have explored where I am lacking and what are the issues that I am facing while learning. The third one, and the very important, is the discovery approach, where you ask the student to have a look to their prior experiences and then discuss the topic ahead. So here what you do is that when you introduce the topic in the classroom, you can ask the students to come forward and let everyone know what they already know about that particular topic, and try to always have such thing in the class that the students already know. Because if the students are having this feel that, okay, this is what something I know, they feel a bit relaxed and they are motivated towards the other sessions. All right, so the session has ended and the questions from your side are welcome. I hope so this was fruitful for you all and you all will be using in your classrooms. If you have any query, any question, then kindly let me know in the chat box. Yes, so I am awaited for the questions. If you have any, kindly drop in the chat box. Yes, as already told, in the secondary grade, you can relate to them. You can give them some practical tasks that can really help them out in doing something. Yes, you'll be getting certificate towards the end of the session. Okay, so Ms. Faiza is saying that she was looking for a session on this topic for too long and it was really interesting and fruitful. Thank you so much. That's so nice, Ms. Faiza Kiran. Ms. Nida Maksud is saying a very informative session and served as a refresher for me. Thank you so much. Okay, Ms. Aisha Yusuf is asking a question that how do we appreciate group work in the classroom? Sometimes it happens that some students feel to be a group leader and stop following their group leader due to some jealousy. Right, okay. So Ms. Aisha, in this situation, what you can do here is that you can simply switch the roles in the class. Like, do not make the same person leader every time. Try to switch the leaders in every class so that every person is getting a chance to be the leader and then they can perform effectively. Because you know that, of course, we all have this feel to be the leader. Okay, Ms. Irma is saying it's very useful. Ms. Kalsom is asking about, would you give some examples what kind of activities which can conduct online for creating intrinsic motivation? There is a confusion, Ms. Kalsom. You are asking about the creation of intrinsic motivation, but which type of lesson you are teaching? It depends, like, is it English, language, or what? If it's English, then you can go towards having a role play. Because that is very interesting. And you can always say, like, you can praise the students towards the end of the session to help them feel motivated. Ms. Muzana is saying, very well delivered. Much appreciated. Jazakallah. Ms. Munazza is saying, informative session. Thank you. Okay, I have rightly got, Ms. Kulsoom, that you were talking about the English language, right? Okay, so what about those who attended late? You will be getting the answer with the admin. Or you may contact our admin for more queries. The session is very fruitful and informative. Thank you so much. I gained too much information from this session. That's great. Thank you so much. All right. Okay, so I am sharing the link of the feedback form as well as the quiz in the chat box. You all are requested to attempt that quiz in order to get the certificate. And you all are requested to share all these feedback in the feedback form. Yes, you all will be getting the certificates, but you are required to fill in the form. I am sharing the link with you all. All right, so the link has been shared. Let me know if you all have seen. All right. Thank you so much, everyone. Allah Hafiz.